Well, I thought this one would be fun. Shoot an actual repair video using my older tape-based high-definition camera with an older tape. This turns into kind of a disaster because, unfortunately, tape has things called dropouts, and I'm going to let them play right through so you can see why tape is such a bad medium. Ugh, glad we got rid of it. Let's set this up and see what we did. For today's video, we're going to go old school. How old school? We're going to shoot this on tape. This is my little HDV camera. I don't even know if it works anymore, so we may not even be doing a video today. But we're going to test this little camera out, and then we're going to shoot the video on this camera. This is my small HDV camera. I actually have a 3-chip one as well that I could use, but we're going to do it on this one just because this one's small enough that I can put it on my existing mount and not have the thing fall over. My other camera is too heavy to put on the jib arm that I've got because it's a FX1 and it's about that big. And I mean, it's got a beautiful picture and everything, but this one here should be every bit as good being a single chip. This one here's got a firewire on here somewhere. There's a firewire there. It's also got a full-size HDMI output, so I can actually plug this into my monitor and see what I'm doing. But more importantly, it uses the same type of battery that my current camera uses. Somehow this battery goes in here. And if I open this up, let's see if it works. And then we'll find something to work on today. I'm not looking forward to this. I have to capture this tape. I have to be a short video. I don't want to be here all day capturing stuff. So there's the unit itself. Let's just see whether it actually records anything. We'll turn it on. Look at that. I've got the image or the lens protector. And I got to set the date and time because this thing hasn't been used since 2006. Yes, that's how old this camera is. 2006. What do we do here to set this thing? 2020. And he gets okay, and then I go December. Today is the 20th. There we go. Okay, let's first of all see whether this thing records. So I'll put it into record, and we'll just do some testing here and see whether this thing works. This camera actually went through an accident years and years ago when I had this one in the saddlebag of my Harley when I was forced off the road by a truck that was running on the wrong side of the road, and I had to put my bike in the ditch. And this was sitting in a saddlebag, and you can see it got banged up here. The saddlebag broke and the camera went flying, and it got pretty banged up, as you can see from the dent. But it didn't damage the camera. The camera actually still worked. It was in a bag. It wasn't just sitting in the saddlebag. It was in a camera case. Camera case itself got pretty banged up. I'll show you the camera case that came out of. I had it in this case, which I still use this case today for one of my other cameras. I got too many cameras. This is the camera I keep in this case. You see, this is my high end that goes on my big professional tripod. Tripod's worth more than the camera. But this is my 4K AX100 camera that I use for my scenery videos and stuff, where I'm doing some nice photography with this, because it's got a 1-inch sensor. Really takes a great picture. 20 megapixels. I think that's the same as the one on this one. This one might even be higher. This one might even be like 20.6. What does this one got? This one's 20.6, believe it or not. The AX33 has a 20.6 megapixel sensor. This one has a 20 megapixel sensor. And the AX53, which I bought to replace my AX33 because I've been having some issues with it, namely the mount. The mount is kind of buggered up on it. I fixed it a few times, but I figured I better grab another camera while I still could. And the new one, I got an AX53. I wanted the AX53 because it still has the Apple viewfinder like this on it. The new one, the AX43, they've made it even cheaper. They've gone down to a 9 megapixel sensor, and which for video, it doesn't really matter because you only need 9 megapixels to shoot 4K. But I use it for stills as well. And this one I'll do a 20 megapixel still. The one that I'm shooting this on will do a 20.6 megapixel still. And the new one will only do, well, say the 43, which doesn't have an eyepiece. It only has 9 megapixels. So they're dropping the price, but they're dropping the quality. The AX100, and I think there's a new one out to replace this, which has also got the 20 megapixel 1-inch sensor. But quality-wise on this thing here, it's pretty tough to beat it in a camcorder of this size. And again, it's old, right? There's newer ones out, but this is my first 4K. And I use it, you know, for certain videos. I haven't used my 3-chip camera much. And I haven't used this thing here in years. But we're going to see how this works, see if it's still working. So I will I'll stop the recording. And we'll flip it to, that's still image. This will do stills too. And play edit. Let's just see if I rewind this tape. We'll see if it plays. And then we'll use this camcorder for the video I'm going to shoot. So let's just make sure that it's actually working before I shoot anything. Looks like it's working. So, without further ado, I'm going to cut over to this one. And we're going to shoot today's video, old style, on this camcorder, of course in HD mode. So it's still going to be an HD video, but you'll see the difference in the quality between the 4 megapixel sensor that's on this, which is also a CMOS, and the 20.6 megapixel sensor that's on the camera that we're shooting with. So I'm going to switch cameras now, and we're going to make a video of something that I hope is going to be of interest. And it'll be an audio component, but I'm keeping you guys in the dark for the moment. But one thing on this other camera I didn't mention was that it has digital memory on this too. It has this one, which is a memory stick. Pretty small by today's standards, 1 gigabyte is all this one is. That was Sony's own design. Now everything, of course, uses SD. I think this camera actually can use memory stick as well as SD. This one here was memory stick only. But what this one used memory sticks for was it used memory sticks for the still pictures. Because you could shoot, and look at this. It has a real flash. It has a Xeon flash tube on it. So this one can actually do very nice. They're only 4 megapixel images. But it can do very nice pictures. Wonder how long ago I took that picture of myself. But again, it can do really good quality pictures because of the flash. This was not a cheap camera when it was new. This was actually quite an expensive camera, being HDV. It was probably, I don't know, I'm guessing it was probably about $1,500 or $1,600. It wasn't cheap. My other one was like $5,000, and this one might have been closer to $2,000. In the day, because this is old. I got this camera, well, I think it was 2006. I got my other one in 2004, my FX1, 2004. Anyway, let's switch over to this one and fix something. First shots that are done on tape. This is the camera that I normally record my YouTube videos with, my little AX33. Probably one of the best small cameras that Sony has ever made. As you can see, I'm having trouble with the mount on this. I've fixed it with epoxy a couple times now, but it just, the way that it hangs on the tripod, because it's hanging by the screw, I was starting to have trouble with it. So I figured I'd buy the AX53 as a replacement, but I haven't switched over to it yet, just because, let's say, the older one works better. Anyway, we're going to set this one aside for today. And let's see what we have to work on. Well, the first thing I've noticed about this camera, and I've actually got it plugged into my plasma so I can see what I'm doing, because my other camera, of course, uses this little micro HDMI, and this one uses a full-size HDMI. So I've got it plugged in with a full-size HDMI cable going to my other TV. The first thing I've noticed, though, is I have to have the camera much higher up, because even zoomed all the way back, the picture is much closer. Let's see how the lens on this one compares, if I want to see how it works for close-up, because I've really never tried this camera in this role. But if I have something in really close, how will the lens on this allow me to zoom in? Pretty good, actually. So I'm down within like an inch of the lens, and I can actually zoom in. This one's got a 10 times zoom on it as well. We'll see how the autofocus works on this. Come on, focus, camera, focus. Not as good as the new camera, that's for sure. The autofocus tended to be having a bit of a problem there. Yes, so that's one thing with the new cameras is, well, at least the AX33, is that I can get in very, very close and get those shots that I've been getting. Almost looks like I'm using a microscope when I'm actually not. And that's one of the reasons I'm still using it, and I haven't replaced it with the 53. This is a Panasonic CD player, not a Techniques. It's the same as a Techniques. This, the same model was marketed as a Techniques. But this one is a SLPS 352 Panasonic. And I have no idea what this thing does. This is mine. It was given to me a couple weeks back. A buddy was cleaning out his dad's old storage unit of his old electronics and stuff. And he was throwing stuff out. He called me up and he says, "Hey, you want some stuff?" So he gave me a CD player and some turntables, and today we're going to see if this thing works. And if it doesn't, we're going to see if we can make it work recording on tape. One thing I have to get used to with using this tape camera is that, I have a time limit of 60 minutes. That's all that I can record on a cassette. The other downside to shooting on tape is that I'm used to being able to, you know, shut the camera off and spend time staring at things and leave the camera on and it's ready to go and I can hit the record button. Of course, you can't do that when you're dealing with tape because the heads are going to continue to rotate. So there's like a timer which will shut it off after a couple minutes so that you don't wear the tape out, because the head on this thing is rotating at 9,000 RPM. Yes, 9,000 RPM is the speed that the head drum rotates on mini DV and HDV camcorders and players. So that tape is just, that head is just screaming. So you don't want to leave it parked with the tape in pause for any length of time or you're going to wear out the tape. So they all have a timer that will stop them from recording or stop them from running, and then you actually have to physically power the camera off and turn it back on again to continue. So that's one thing that's different. When I'm dealing with tape, I have to keep in mind that if I'm going to stop and pause for any reason, I actually have to stop and turn the power off, otherwise it's going to turn off on its own and then I gotta reset it. Okay, the inside of this thing, pretty straightforward. Like most of the Techniques and Panasonic units, this uses a linear motor. So there's no gears. That was the nice thing. The downside to that is what people always forgot to do is when you transport these things, you're supposed to push this lever in, this button in. What that does is that locks the laser so that it can't move back and forth. And everybody seemed to forget to lock the laser. When you lock it, you're supposed to turn the unit over on its back like that, right, and then push the block in and it'll lock it from moving. Otherwise, when it's shipped, the laser can slam back and forth. Tells you what to do here. It says if the unit is transported, remove the disc, turn the power off, place the unit with the rear panel facing downward and push the lock to the lock position. You'd be amazed at the number of people that didn't do that and ended up with a damaged traverse from it slamming back and forth. Let's see, first of all, whether this thing works. Maybe this CD player works. Maybe it doesn't. That I don't know. So let's find out. Grab a disc. CDR. Oh, nice CDR. Nice and scuffed. See if it'll, well, the display light's up. Let's got a nice blue. Wow, that is a nice looking fluorescent display. We need a load belt for starters. That might be all this needs is a load belt. I don't hear any sound. That's not it. I am on the right input, I think. Yeah, I am on the right input. I don't hear any sound on this thing. Okay, so it appears to have a problem. No sound. Interesting. Let's see what's going on. I mean, I'm really curious on this. You can see that the tape the counter is moving, so we know it's playing. If I turn up the volume, you can hear music playing. What I'm curious is, does this unit have a variable output for the output level that was controlled by the remote control, and somebody turned it all the way down and misplaced the remote? The reason I suggest that is because I had one that was just like that. I had a different brand of unit that no sound and or low sound, and it was the output was turned down. It had a variable output that could be adjusted by the remote control. I don't know why companies do that. You know, it's one of the stupidest things. Have a variable output that you can only adjust with the remote, and then if that remote gets damaged or lost, you're kind of screwed. I think sometimes companies did that intentionally. I'm going to look up this thing. I'm going to look up the remote for this thing and see whether this particular model actually used a remote that had a volume control on it. That might be all that's wrong with this thing. And if that's the case, hopefully my universal remote will work it. But let's do some research. Well, of course, as my luck had it, this being a Panasonic version, not a Techniques version, it has no remote control. The remote control on this was through a plug that it picked up the signals from the stereo system. So I'm going to try doing a factory reset on this thing. And I don't know whether this is going to work on this or not, but on most of these units, if you press and hold the clear button, and while holding the clear button, you'll press the power. On most of these, they will do a factory reset. And I'm wondering whether that is going to get sound back, which of course it doesn't.
Uh-oh. Hear that sound? That's the tape in the camera. I have a feeling we're going to start getting into some dropouts here pretty quick. The tape is starting to squeak. Sticky shed syndrome on the metal evaporated tape. Oh. This video may end abruptly here if this continues. That squeaking sound is being picked up by the microphone. That's actually the tape in the camera. I didn't hear that when it was recording. But that's actually the tape going over the guides in the camcorder. Oh, here we go. It started. This is why tape sucks. And tape always will suck. Yeah. Oh, there we go. Yep, tape. This video may come to an end. We'll see. It may come to an end soon. But all tapes, I don't give a damn what brand they are. They're all old now. This tape's probably 10 years old. It's only been used like once or maybe twice. But all tape, it's crap. So any of you thinking of, I'm just going to keep my cameras work, get your stuff off of tape and throw the stuff away.
In the audio circuit here. To confirm my theory, if I put my scope on this capacitor here, I have signal. Therefore, if I were to take my have sound. Left channel and right channel. But I don't have sound out here. maybe it's a crack on the board here. Let's just pop the board out and take a look at what's happening. I've got sound. Oh, we got sound. Let's pop the board out. Sound right here. But I didn't have sound on the... But
if you're wondering why the sound sounds like it's getting out of sync, that's just the dropouts. It's throwing the sound way out of sync from the video. As you can see.
See, when I'm recording on my other camera, I don't really worry of me horsing around here, and then I can edit it after the fact. But when I'm on a, I gotta kind of watch my recording and try to keep this relatively short, because it's gonna take me just as long to capture. So if I record an hour, I'm gonna be sitting there for an hour waiting for it to dump into the computer before I can add without having to disconnect the connections. I wonder if it's just that. I'm thinking, yeah, these are cracked here. I don't know if I can get a camera like I could with my other one, but there's our problem. You see? There's our problem right there. Excellent. Nice, simple repair. I like it. I might even use this CD player, even though it doesn't have a remote. I might even take this thing in the house and use it in the house. Comment about my soldering iron tip being for a number 10 gauge wire. Actually, it's not, but it does a good amount of heat when you're soldering big connections. It makes things a little easier. I do, in addition to this one, it's the job done.
This is a fair warning for anybody who's got tapes on mini DV, whether they're in HDV or standard DV format. Get your material off those tapes, because they have just as many problems on mini DV. It'll just go into a bunch of little square blocks. On HDV, because of the long GOP, the picture actually cuts out and you lose a couple seconds. But the results are the same. This tape sticks to the guides and stuff. The tension errors, or tension goes up and causes errors.
If I get sound, which I'm pretty sure I will, then it's going to be seconds on a part and change the belt. We'll do it for this one. So there's that power. Okay, that's the input. Where's my output?
I'm kind of kicking myself for doing an actual repair video using this old archaic technology. I didn't think it was going to be this bad. I thought maybe it'd be the odd dropout, but I had no idea that it was going to be as bad as it is. So I apologize for that, guys. I should never have tried to do this on tape. And I never will use tape again. I promise.
Linear tracking units, where they were fast. There's track number 20. One of the problems with the older CDRs, like these ones, is that they were, well, they're dark, right? So they don't have as high a reflectivity as the newer ones. And that was kind of a double-edged sword, because, of course, the advantage, because they're slower write speed, these ones I think were only, four times? Or eight times? What is this one? I don't know if it says on here. What is it? Eight times. This is eight times. And the advantage to these ones with the eight times recording speed was that sensitive to light. So they weren't as liable to be damaged if they were exposed to sample, which you should never do to an optical disc anyway. But these ones here, because of here. And it took more to expose them, whereas these ones here that are 52 times, well, they're literally almost silver, as you can see by comparison. These are very sensitive, but they also have a very high reflectivity, which makes these ones more compatible with CD players, especially the older CD. that were around from before when I was wondering what was beeping. It was actually, I think, something just beeped here. These were around before CDRs designed to play CDRs. So this thing is now, except for that horrible noise in the mechanism. So I think we will take this thing apart and lubricate it. To do that, we're going to remove the front cover just so that I can get the deck out of here a little easier so that it just slides out of the way. Now I can remove the four screws and lift the mechanism up. I should be able to lift this whole mechanism out now, just like that. Put that unit out of the way. And the one that was squeaking, I think, is this one over here. This motor here is what operates the load and unload. There's a belt on here. And if I turn this gear from down below, I should be able to eject. Or I can just apply power to it. That might be easier. We'll just apply power to the motor and make sure that the laser's not locked when I do this. There we go. I'll just apply power to the motor and that'll open it up. Okay. I remove the disc clamp by pulling over in the plastic. You gotta be careful. This plastic is old. It'll be brittle, so you gotta be really careful on this old stuff because you don't want to snap it. There is the belt. And is it slipping or is it just the gears are noisy? Let's just see if it's slipping. Oh, it's not. It's not slipping at all, so it's just these gears are noisy, and this bearing is probably noisy down here underneath this wheel. So if we can get some lubricant into these gears that are making all that racket, then this thing should be nice and quiet. See this? I love it. These units here never gave us much trouble, and you don't even really need to grease the rails on here because if you notice, it's running on a roller. See that? These ones did not give much problem. Linear motor is great. Even the spindle motors on these ones were pretty good. We didn't have a lot of problems with the spindle motors on these particular units. They were actually quite good, these traverses. These ones are all manually adjustable, as you can see, all the controls down here to set them up. There was a jig that Panasonic had that plugged into, there's a plug right down there. You can see my finger pointing at it. There was a plug that plugged in there, and there was a jig, and you put the test disc in, you plugged your jig in, and then you adjusted these controls. Yeah, you took the circuit board obviously to do it. You did it with the board lying out, and then you could plug the jig in and you adjusted the controls, and there was like LEDs. There was like two red LEDs and a green LED, and you just adjusted them until each of the green LEDs were on, and the gain, you adjusted the gain for maximum gain. This is before we used scopes on a lot of the stuff. They actually had a jig for these decks, and I had one because Panasonic made us buy one back in the day. We had to buy a jig for the stupid camera or for the stupid CD player to work on them, and that jig was like $1,800. And in order to keep our warranty status, we had to buy it. And I remember the service manager, good old Steve Junson, calling us up saying we needed to have this if we wanted to maintain our warranty depot status. So I said, oh yeah, I'll send one over. I didn't realize it was $1,800. He just said we had to have the jig. The jig arrives, and then the bill arrived for it. And the boss went ballistic on me. He went absolutely nuclear on me. I'm surprised I didn't get fired that day. He was so mad that this part had come in. And he says, why did you order that thing? I said, because I was told that I had to have it or we would lose our warranty status. And the boss was not too happy about that. I think it got used once too. We used it once the entire time. We made like $50 on a repair and used an $1,800 jig one time. But that's what it was like back in those early days. The manufacturers made you have their specific test tools, and if you didn't have their test tools, you couldn't play. You couldn't play in the sandbox if you didn't have the tools that they wanted you to have. I'm just putting a drip, just a drop of oil down onto this bearing here. It does not come apart. It's a pressed-in bearing, so there's no way to take it apart. It's a plastic gear, so I'm probably doing it more damage. But I just want to try and quieten it down a bit. Same with this other one over here. Just put a little bit of oil down into that one. See if that will quieten this thing down when I load and unload it. We'll put the power back on the motor here and load it in place and see whether this quietens it down at all. That's a little better. You can try and get just a spot of oil down into here. If I can get a little bit of oil down off of that motor shaft and let it run down into the motor, that's just better. There, I got some oil into the motor shaft. It should run down. Gravity should take it down into the bearing. Okay, time to put this thing back together. One of the reasons I'm doing this on tape today is just because somebody made some comment about how they like tape and they wish we were still using tape. So I'm actually hoping that some of the pitfalls of tape will show up on this, and those being dropouts. Tape, or big time dropouts on tape, and on HD tape there. Oops, I don't have this in place properly. Not closing up. On HD tape, in particular, when you get a dropout, the dropout typically lasts for, a few seconds. That's why. Silly me. I had the laser lock still in place, and that will prevent the chuck from chucking. I'm gonna put the back cover on now, and then we'll test it and put the rest of it together. Anyway, as I was saying about tape, I don't miss tape. I don't miss videotape. I don't miss HDV. I liked HDV. It was the best that we had at the time before we got into file-based systems with SD cards. I don't miss tape at all. I think it had its day, and its days are done, and we've moved on, and there's no reason to go back to the past as far as recording on tape goes. There are far better ways, I think, far more reliable ways. SD cards are one of them for our cameras and so forth. Yes, SD cards can have problems. You can certainly lose data. Anybody who's ever rejected an SD card without first waiting for the light to go out to indicate that the writing is finished will know what I'm talking about. We've all done it. I've done it. Anybody who's had an SD card fail, they'll be angry about losing their stuff, and that's happened. I've had three SD cards and a USB stick that has failed in the last couple years, and I've learned to keep backup copies of everything. But uh, SD cards don't get eaten by the camera or the player or the tape deck. SD cards are not affected by magnetism like magnetic tape is. And they're instant access. So they have a lot going for them. This one's fixed. It was quite a simple problem in the end. Just broken connections here on the output. And it didn't. When I plugged them in, normally when you plug these things in and unplug them, you get intermittent sound, which I didn't get initially. So I put the scope over here and I had sound. And I could hear sound when I cranked it up. It was just leakage, obviously, across the open gap there. But the real clue came when I went to, when I was gonna unplug it and go like this to hear the sound, because I knew I had sound here, and I heard the sound kick in. It's like, wait a minute, I have broken connections on this thing. So that's all it was. That and lubricating those gears to make it quiet. This one's fixed. This one's mine. And I'm going to put this one in use because I have a need for a single disc CD player in my living room, basically. I've got a 200 disc changer in there, which I use all the time. But every so often I'll get one disc and I want to listen to one disc. So on my 200 disc CD player, usually like spot number 200, I don't have a disc in it. So I just load it into that spot. But it's a heck of a lot more convenient just to plug in a single disc, and if I have a disc I want to listen to, I can just fire it in and play it. And that's what's going to happen with this one. Okay, that about does it for this one. Of course, we have to go through this process, removing the tape and transferring it over to the computer. But there's my little camcorder. Gotta love that marvel of technology, that tiny little transport. Okay, thanks for watching. We will catch you in the next one. Bye for now.